Ultima ponente es Marco Daas, de Oregon University, que ahora está dedicado a proyectos sobre la comida en la literatura medieval española. El título de su ponencia es Consumption and the Soul, a Gustatory Journey through the Mester de CLERECÍA.
So I suggest everybody feel like seriously stand up for a second. I'm not kidding. Everybody looks so, I mean, no, I think everybody should stand up for just a second and stretch, and everybody should stretch. Yeah. Yeah. All of the ponencias and really, you know, having great comments. I mean, it's just been an amazing conference. So it's been a wonderful experience so far. And I'm finally, it's me. I'm the end, the bitter end. Speaking of bitter, hopefully my food isn't too bitter. This is a part of a much bigger project that I'm working on and will be working on for a while. I've just sort of been digging away at food, so both eating and abstaining from eating embody powerful spiritual choices. Christ, challenged by the devil to transform a stone into bread to relieve his hunger, chose instead to abstain. Adam and Eve, however, transgressed God's will in the Garden of Eden, precisely through the act of eating. Eating represents a material temptation which leads the sinner to commit more spiritual sins. However, man is also redeemed through an act of eating. By the end of the 12th century, the word transubstantiation was widely used, although its concept had been accepted as an informal tenet much earlier. The Fourth Lateran Council, in its first canon, declared the truth of transubstantiation. It reads, quote, in which there is the same priest and sacrifice, Jesus Christ, whose body and blood are truly contained in the sacrament of the altar under the forms of bread and wine, the bread being changed, transubstantiatio, by divine power into the body, and the wine into the blood, so that to realize the mystery of unity, we may receive of him what he has received of us. The mystery of transubstantiation is evident throughout the texts of the Mester de CLERECÍA in the references, both metaphoric and literal, to bread. Richard Terry Knopp writes that Berfeo's development of bread imagery relates directly to the Eucharist and his preoccupation with the bread of the Mass. The host, then, as the holiest of foodstuffs, could only be made with the finest material, which in the Middle Ages meant wheat. And all of my pictures, I just put them up because they're pretty. But, you know, we like to look at pretty things, right? Are from the Tafinan Sanitatis. In his Sacrificio de la Misa, Berfeo writes, el pan de que se face debe ser de trigo. Otra mezcla ninguna no la quiere consigo. The importance of wheat figures even more officially in the Siete Partidas. En este pan la que llaman hostia ha de ser de farina de trigo. Wheat appears in the medieval dietetics manuals as the most desirable of grains. In the manual known as the Sevillana Medicina by Juan de Avignon, written in the early 15th century, wheat bread is la más igual simiente que sea en el mundo para el cuerpo del hombre. Y el trigo es caliente, en primer grado, igual entre humedad y sequedad. Bread, then, is both a humble Christian repast and a powerfully transformative element. It represents both the penitent meal and the meal of enlightenment. Throughout the Milagros, the host is associated both with Christ as the embodiment of the bread and the Virgin, referred to as the Madre del Pan de Trigo. Carolyn Walker Bynum writes that from the very beginning, quote, the Eucharistic elements stood primarily not for nature, for grain and grape, but for human beings bound into community by commensality, end quote. Nowhere is this shown more clearly than in Berthel's tale of Enjude. In the text, the boy takes communion on Easter Sunday. The holiest of Christian holidays is the setting for the transformative nature of the Eucharist. The Jewish boy is swept up in the proceedings of the Christian community and simply does as they do. His very act of taking communion, however, transforms him into a Christian and is thus punished by his father for his act of betrayal. The punishment meted out by the enraged father has been well analyzed. However, I would like to point out the presence of the oven in the Jewish home. In the Middle Ages, communal ovens were very common. However, Jews were not often allowed to bake their unleavened bread in Christian ovens. Therefore, it was necessary to maintain Jewish ovens. In this case, the Jewish oven, however, betrays its very nature by protecting the innocent child, who has become one with Christ through the act of communion, and therefore is protected from being burned or baked, while the Jewish father is burned beyond recognition. At the end of the miracle, Berthel reinforces the nature of the host and the inherent goodness or godliness of wheat by telling us that when the Virgin is pleased, she will give los buenos pan de trigo y los malos arena. Oats in the Middle Ages were considered to be animal food and therefore not fit for human consumption, except apparently by the Scots. You know, they're always eating porridge, right? I love a porridge, I eat it every morning. The transformative power of communion is clearly demonstrated in the final miracle tale of Teofilo. After having sold his cell to the devil, Teofilo is accused of having asked for better than wheat bread. Demandar mejor de pan de trigo. Since pan de trigo is literally the best bread that exists, and figuratively Christ, it is one of the worst accusations that can be made to any Christian. For his penance, Teofilo first must maintain abstinence in both food and drink in order to prepare for his transformation from grave sinner to penitent Christian. Teofilo receives the Corpus Domini in front of the entire congregation, which allows him to become a full-fledged member of the Christian community again. Wheat bread is not only the holiest of foods, but it is also food for the wealthy. For the poor laborer in the pobre caritativo, wheat bread is as common as hen's teeth. The Virgin Mary promises the man that he will receive the finest food in heaven. In this case, it happens to be pan de trigo candeado. There is, according to the Virgin, no finer food, as it is both the most superior bread, surely never before eaten by this poor man, and also representative of For the poor, barley bread was the most common. Barley bread makes an appearance in the abadesa preñada as representative of something undesirable. In order to demonstrate the hateful feelings the nuns harbored toward their abbess, Berthel writes that they made their dough with barley flour. Hició la abadesa fuera del consistorio, como mandó el obispo, o fuera diversorio. Hicieron su cabello, la ira y el odio, amasaron su masa de farina de ordio. Although barley flour is considered second best, according to medieval manuals, it is still far inferior to the Christ-like wheat flour. Bynum writes that the meaning of food and hunger changed in the Middle Ages. Hunger meant human vulnerability, which God comforted with food, or it meant human self-control, adopted in an effort to keep God's commandments. To eat God was to become suffering flesh. It was to imitate the cross. No poem more aptly describes the phenomenon of suffering flesh better than the poem of Santa Maria Egipsiaca. Santa Maria spends the first half of her life living quite intemperately. She is guilty of consuming all the pleasures of life. She is equally desirous of sexual encounters and the consumption of good foods. E por feto su vicio los mantenía a gran delicio en beber y en comer y folía cuidar noche y día. However, the Egipsiaca has a change of heart that leads her to a life of abstinence and penance. She begins her new life by entering the desert with the most basic of foods, three breads. These breads are loaded with meaning. They are the penitent's most basic repast, they are Maria's only sustenance for years, and they represent the Eucharistic meal. For Maria, the scarcity of food and the harshness of the desert strip her of her gluttonous fleshly desires. Penance at this time generally took the form of abstinence from all comforts, food, drink, sex, and soft living. This extreme of penance, however, was often looked upon as suspicious, bordering on heretical. Yet the life of Mary of Egypt provided a context for penance that could not just be tolerated, but admired and imitated. After the first year of desert life, Maria has eaten all her bread and proceeds to eat wild herbs and drink water. She lives this way for many years. She then lives for 30 more years only on manna from heaven. Non comió cosa ninguna si el ángel no se lo traía. However, it is not until Maria receives her final, receives her final meal that she is allowed to die in peace. From Gozimo, she makes one request to be given the Holy Eucharist. Mas una cosa te ruego mucho, en vaso que sea limpio, mente el cuerpo de Jesucristo. Y de besarme otro vaso que sea bien alimpiado. Y contigo lo traerás, y más cerca de mí me fallarás. Quiero ser condenada, que por ello seré apropiada. Que cuando pase el flumoneo Jordán, sobre la ribera de San Juan, no recibí yo el cuerpo de mi Señor, de que he yo gran dolor. Gozimas indulges what turns out to be her last request. When she finally appears, Gozimas addresses her once again. Esto sepas que es pan, es cuerpo de Jesucristo, que por nos priso martirio. ¿Crees este, amigo mío, amiga mía? Bien lo creo, dijo María, por la gran culpa que Adán hizo, por la manzana que hizo. Food, according to Caroline Walker Bynum, has always been a female concern, and historically the longest fasts were held by women. Indeed, traditionally only female saints fasted until death. Aquinas believed that women fasted to bridle lust rather than to imitate the suffering Christ. Although it is true that Maria went into the desert originally to temper her material desires, she changed from anti-saint to icon of holiness. Fruit. Let's get off the bread. Food in the literature of the Mester de CLERECÍA maintains a dual nature. Bread can be both good, pan de trigo, and bad, avena y cebada. Fruit, too, appears as both holy and sinful. The clearest examples of good fruits appear in the introduction of the Milagros. As the virginal paradise, Mary is both fount and fruit. She is alternatively budding fruit trees, pomegranates, almonds, and grapes. Berceo reminds us, however, that fruit was also the cause of the fall and therefore can lead one to grave temptations. In the Libro de Buen Amor, fruit is used as an enticement in the wooing scenes between the aptly named Don Melon and Doña Andrina. Lovesick Melon, himself of a cold and damp temperament, is looking for warmth from Andrina. Trotaconventos expends much energy trying to convince her, and finally succeeds by offering her tasty treats. In stanza 861, Trotaconventos offers Andrina silly games and nuts, and in 862, Nunca está mi tienda sin fruta a las manzanas. Muchas peras y duraznos, qué sidras y qué manzanas, qué castañas, qué piñones y qué muchas avellanas. Las que vos queréis, mucho, estas vos serán más sanas. Andrina agrees to go with her to tomar de la su fruta y a la tela jugar. The fruit that she will try is, of course, Don Melón. Fruit may have been the temptation of Eden, but meat is one of the primary causes of carnality in the Middle Ages. The Libro de Buen Amor is full of carnal acts, resulting seemingly from the consumption of warming foods. We see this clearly in the scenes with the serranas. The menu the first serrana provides for the arcipreste is filled with aphrodisiacs. Gazapo, tender young rabbit, perdices, asadas, vino, queso, y carne de choto o cabrito. These foods were known for their warming qualities and the promotion of lasciviousness. The Serrano also offers pan mal amasada. The poorly kneaded bread can have a variety of meanings. As we saw with the abadesa preñada and the nuns, with their bread kneaded with barley flour, and also the mala farina that the abbess is emptied of once the Virgin Mary has removed the baby. In this case, if bread is poorly kneaded, it is not kneaded spiritually, but rather is not a not very subtle metaphor for intercourse. The second serrana, after hitting the arcipreste on the head, promises him a buena medrina. The arcipreste insists that he cannot luchar on an empty stomach. His song tells us that the serrana hospedome y diome vianda. She invited him in and gave him meat. Consumption in this case refers both to eating and to sexual intercourse. In the Middle Ages, physicians used the humoral method as a means to define human temperament and health. The logic followed that if humans had a particular temperament, so too did foodstuffs, which influenced humans as much as their environment did. And the art of cookery developed around the idea of improving the humoral qualities of a particular foodstuff. The medieval health handbooks tend to agree on the warming nature of meats. In order to eschew sexuality, one must steer clear of meat. The association of sex and gluttony is clearly delineated in the scenes of Don Carnal and Doña Cuaresma. Like the Egipcianca, Don Carnal's gluttony led him to further sin. Poor Don Carnal is given a strictly vegetarian diet to cool his sanguine nature. From the protection of the Jewish quarter, Carnal sends a challenging missive to Cuaresma, calling her a mala flemosa. Apart from the general characterization of Lent as a thin, pinched woman, she is also, unfortunately, phlegmatic. This indication of her temporal nature would have been most comical to a medieval audience. And to an audience of medievalists. According to the scientific treatises of the time, a phlegmatic would have been described as, what I've got here, flemáticos, fuerzas flacas, son anchos y bajos, las flemas es ate pingües y la sangre moderados, no se dan al estudio sino al ocio, al sueño, etc. This comes from the Antietética Medieval de Villanova. The scenes from the Jewish quarter give us insight into the social and religious realities of the 14th century. The list of animals fleeing for their lives upon Carnal's arrival is a list of kosher meats, cabrones, cabritos, carneros, y ovejas. And Carnal's choice of hiding spot tells us much of the segregative nature of a Spanish medieval city. According to the laws concerning Jews from the Siete Partidas, the Jews were forbidden to leave their neighborhoods on Good Friday. Don Carnal knew that he could escape to the Jewish quarter because no Christian would dare look for him there. This was also La Pascua del Pan Centeno, or Centeno, the holiday of unleavened bread or Passover. Carnal knew that he would be well received during the celebration. Fuyó de la iglesia, fuese a la jodería, refirieronlo muy bien en su carnicería. Pascua del Pan Centeno, estos les venían. And Michelle Hamilton, who's not here anymore, was talking about that buen día being, you know, the celebration of Passover. Through the study of food and its consumption, we can see how religion, language, and materiality intersect. Lisa Vitale writes, quote, medieval Dominicans, such as Albert the Great and Aquinas, discussed original sin in relationship to gluttony. Its remediation was to be sought not only through abstinence, especially from food, but through preaching and praising God. The mouth, then, is the root of sin and the central focus of its correction. End quote. The medieval attitude toward food, its preparation, and its consumption gives us much insight into the way in which the people reacted toward religion and its strictures. How food appears in literature also allows us to begin to understand the stresses and strains under which the people labored. The segregative nature of many laws appearing in the literature, including medieval canon law, which condemned outright the Christian consumption of meat coming from Jewish butcher shops. Carnal knows that he will be safe hiding in the Jewish quarter among the Jewish butchers, as no Christian would be looking there. The medieval attitude toward food in general is reflected throughout the Mester and CLERECÍA. Starvation, plague, religious strife, and war were all part of daily life. Doctors prescribed chicken, partridge, and eggs, but warned against beef, duck, lamb, goat, rabbit, and pork during the plague. Apples and pears were to accompany the first meal of the day, and all fish was bad except lobster. Other texts allow us to glimpse medieval daily practices and how people lived regardless of religious strictures. Espadas Burgos writes, El vino, pese a las prohibiciones coránicas, siguiendo una vena de heterodoxia de antaño frecuente en el mundo hispano-musulmán, y que quedará no solo reflejada en la literatura, sino en la microliteratura, que es el mundo del refranero. I'm sure we've all heard this, moro fino, come tocino y bebe vino. The world of the refranero is rich with food references and is the subject of another paper. However, it shows how much daily life and the one prescribed by religion can differ. The texts of the Mester and CLERECÍA do the same. They show both how important fasting could be, especially for women, and how loosely religious-based food abstentions can be interpreted. Through an examination of the depictions of food and consumption in these texts, we are given insight into